So the going back to the WTO, there are all of these rules. One of those sets of rules, and one that is probably the least known amongst all the WTO rules, is that there is a WTO Financial Services Agreement, the FSA. In the case of the WTO Financial Services Agreement, you cannot find a congressman who even knows what it is and why. Because the Clinton administration signed us onto it in 1999 without holding a vote in Congress. They just signed on as the executive, but it is still binding, like the WTO's other agreements, which were bound by Congress. And again, because we are obliged to conform all domestic laws, regulations, and administrative procedures to the attached agreements, that means that the U.S. regime of financial services, banks, securities, derivatives, insurance firm regulation is supposed to follow these WTO rules in this financial services agreement. Now, what is in there? And we've been doing a lot of research into where this agreement came from. And it's been helpfully aided by the Vanity Press published book of the former vice president of American Express, who helpfully explains how he largely wrote the agreement, along with friends from AIG, Citibank, and a few other behemoths. And he gives, because he's bragging about his genius, all of the names and dates and locations of he and his corporate friends sitting down cozy in Geneva with various U.S. officials. It started, this negotiation, way back when the WTO started. But so many countries objected to the notion that you would have the WTO bind deregulation of their banks, insurance, etc. So many governments had nationally run banks that a lot of countries said, okay, this trade stuff a little scary, we'll try that. We're going to like let some foreign institution decide our domestic finance regulation? No, we're not. So many countries said no, that when the WTO was established, what was called the end of the Uruguay round of GATT negotiations, that ended in 1994. When that happened, a lot of countries said, no way. So the U.S. listed a whole set of financial services that we agreed we would submit to these WTO rules, but we made it conditional on other countries actually agreeing to submit more of their services. And so we made a deal where we said, okay, we'll just hold our nose and we'll sign this WTO now, but we get guaranteed a restart of just financial services negotiations to make everyone else sign up, and that is exactly what happened. And those negotiations went on totally under the radar, with no official announcement, no due delegation of authority from Congress, because Congress under the U.S. Constitution, Article 1A, has exclusive authority over trade, has to delegate the authority, did not get a delegation, did not get a vote at the end. The Treasury Department negotiated this huge, complex agreement. It is a strict deregulation agreement. It is an agreement, the U.S. has signed up almost all of our banking, insurance, and securities. To describe how extreme our levels of submission to these rules, the only area of securities where we took an exception, there are two. One is government bond sureties. Who can underwrite a big bond, basically, that the government's going to insure? Second, other only exception, keep in mind, securities is where derivatives and all these other debt swap instruments are. The only other thing we took out, onion futures. Every other aspect of securities, stocks, derivatives, we submitted to the constraints of the WTO. We are still allowed to regulate onion derivatives. Now, obviously, that's going to have to be changed, because we're now talking about things like banning whole classes of derivative instruments. But these are the rules under this WTO agreement. Number one, if you've taken a commitment and we've locked up everything, you cannot ban a service or a product in that area, neither domestically nor for the foreign company. These rules apply absolutely. It doesn't apply just not discriminating against the foreign company. You simply cannot do certain things. This is Article 16 of the GATS. It just simply is an absolute prohibition on regulating limits on the number of products that can be offered. So you can't ban something like a toxic type of financial service. The size. You cannot limit things on the basis of size. Again, even if you have a domestic rule that says to avoid too big to fail problems, we are guaranteeing no bank has more than, you know, name your amount of assets. Which is what, by the way, a lot of very conservative economists like Simon Johnson, the former chief economist of the IMF, is suggesting we ought to do. We now have the same companies coming back for the Doha round. The best way to describe the Doha round of WTO expansion is, it's all the really, really extremely outrageously horrific stuff that was in NAFTA and CAFTA that the Europeans, India, and other big WTO countries finally just said, basta, no way to, in WTO. So it's all the leftovers of the most extreme pieces of the NAFTA-WTO model that are in NAFTA-CAFTA that couldn't get into WTO. It's a really toxic agenda that's going to make a lot of the crises facing our world, from climate to the food crisis to the employment crisis, yet worse, because it's just speeding up and intensifying in the same direction. Well, one of the three main pillars of the Doha Round is more financial service deregulation. So the G20 communique is going to have section A. They're going to sign up a commitment, a pledge, that they are going to re-regulate financial services because they have learned the horrific lesson of what happens when you don't regulate that sector. Item B will be, we all pledge to finish the Doha Round because it will save the world and save us from economic crisis. Now, this is exactly, we will re-regulate. We will do WTO, where we will oblige to deregulate. Now, what they need to do is go back and renegotiate the existing WTO rules in financial services. And there's some very specific demands that are being put forward by a global campaign of civil society groups. Our world is not for sale. It's a network of national coalitions, labor federations, so Public Services International has been one of the big leaders on all of the service sector global campaigning. And the way this campaigning works is that we coordinate internationally. The best thing we could do in the U.S. is just to neutralize the people in the Treasury Department, because, little secret among friends, I know that tape recorder's on, Timothy Geithner, our current Treasury Secretary, was the final Clinton administration official who brought home the WTO Financial Services Agreement. And what's worse, there's been no commitment yet to implement President Obama's very impressive campaign commitments to review, renegotiate certain agreements, including WTO. And he talked specifically about how important it was to make sure that we had the regulatory space we needed so we get the benefits of trade without undermining regulation that was legitimate and being trashed, as he said, and as the Democratic campaign platform said, by these existing trade agreements. So, the international campaign has four main demands. Number one is do no further harm. So no, the Doha Round should not include more financial service deregulation. And now we actually have the documents of the negotiations on services and financial services, so we actually know exactly what is being asked for. And here's one of the doozies. There's a set of limits on all regulation of accountancy, that was drafted by Arthur Anderson. Number two is to roll back the existing WTO rules that right now literally obligate over 100 countries to do exactly the thing that caused the crisis. So there are 100 countries that are bound to the existing deregulatory requirements of WTO. Number three, they need to add a safeguard provision, a provision that basically says any country that has what's called a prudential measure, those are measures for the stability of the financial system, for consumers, for the solvency of banks, that those measures are not subject to WTO challenge and that the government gets to decide what's prudential and what isn't. So the way it works right now, and if you raise this issue and you run into someone who knows anything about this topic, they'll say, oh, don't worry, there's a prudential measures exception in that agreement. And that provision that they refer to is in the GATS, annex on financial services. And what it literally says is, section one, no country will be penalized for putting in place measures required to maintain, prudential measures required to maintain stability of the financial system. Sentence two, however, this shall not apply to any domestic measure that undermines any other WTO commitment or provision. By the way, the WTO has its own court system, tribunals that can impose trade. Actually one of the only enforceable forms of international law. The U.S. has dumped the Endangered Species Act, a whole bunch of our trade law safeguard cases, our CAFE standards have been watered down because of WTO challenges, endangered species rules, dolphin protections, because we were told by one of these WTO tribunals, either change your law or we're going to penalize you with billions of dollars in indefinite trade sanctions. And this happened, that's why India changed its constitution, it was facing billions in trade sanctions. So this is actually an enforceable set of rules. So what we have to do, basically, is get rid of these limits and put in place an exception. So the safeguard exception right now would be, for instance, if I decide that your domestic prudential measure, for instance, you decide you want a 50% leverage rate instead of, you know, a 20% leverage rate for a certain kind of security, which means you have to keep 50% of the actual principal in the bank before you can actually loan on it. So let's say I want to make sure you're not going to end up running out of money, and so I raise up the percentage. If you're a foreign bank, you could then get your government to come take me to WTO. And then what I would try to do is use the provision that's supposed to allow me to have prudential measures. But I can't, because I've just violated the market access rules I was describing before. And then the fourth piece of it is the accountancy rules. And there's another negotiation like that that's across the board limits on domestic regulations of services, not just financial services, all services, is another agreement that they've set up where you basically would have any, even non-discriminatory, treats domestic and foreign the same, regulation of any service sector. So this gets into healthcare, because the US, the Clinton administration, submitted health insurance to WTO coverage. Just FYI.